Now, our final guest in today's show. You know when you get a book into the office, Sue, because a lot of books come into Five. People send books to Five Live.
Yeah.
And they're strewn all over the place. It's kind of like an untidy library, the Five Live office. And this one fell in the desk of Patrick, who works in the show and runs the show along with Claire. And it was called Flying Over an Olive Grove, which for a start is just an amazing name for a book before we can go any further. And it's a remarkable story of a footballer called Fred Spikesley. Some people will know, most people won't. It's written by three men. There's a foreword from Chris Waddle, Five Lives Own, in there as well. And Mark Metcalf, one of the authors of this book, joins us now. Just as I show Neil Delamere the front cover of the book, I mean, that is sensational, isn't it? The old style footballer in the front.
And the moustache.
Yeah, sort of. Good old what?
Looks great.
It would be the way to sum up that picture. And Mark joins us now. Hi, Mark.
How are you doing? You all right?
Yeah, really good. It's really nice to have you on. And just paint a picture of a footballer that once you read the book and start reading the book, you realise, how do we not already know more about this man?
Well, it's a long time ago and it needed a great deal of research to bring the story alive. And Clive and Ralph, Clive being related to Fred Spikesley, spent about 20 years doing the research on him, and that was helped by the fact that Fred was a remarkable character who twice wrote his own autobiography and also was very popular with the newspapers. So, for example, when he managed to escape from a German prison at the beginning of the First World War, the first thing he did when arriving back in Sheffield was to go to the local newspapers and be interviewed about his experiences. So they have managed to bring those great stories about his remarkable life, back to print, basically.
He's described as outside of being a great footballer, a gambler, a womaniser, a stage performer.
He was certainly that. He actually dies aged 78, running to collect his winnings on Ladies' Day at Goodwood. He lived during the World War in East London with his German wife, which must have been quite remarkable, 20 years his junior. As a gambler, he lost jobs because he refused to commit to not going horse racing, and he certainly lost the Watford job in 1906, and there were other jobs. He went bankrupt regularly. At the same time, he must have had some success because he did manage to work as a gambler from about 1927 till his death in 1948. Mm. So he can't have been too bad.
Well, I mean, some of the things are unbelievable. He scored the fastest unofficial FA Cup goal. A hat-trick on his England debut against Wales.
Yes.
First player to score a hat-trick against Scotland. So he was, as you would just say, as simply as you can, and Sheffield Wednesday fans listening now, the Isles will all know him. He was some pop, as we say over here, wasn't he? He was some footballer.
What he was, Fred Spikesley, more than anything, was he was a big game player.
Yeah.
You do have players who are very good players, but who cannot perform on the big stage. Spikesley was one of those players. He was a great player initially for Gainsborough Trinity. Trinity won their league in 1891, and he was the star of that show. But when he went to Wednesday, he helped take Wednesday into the league in 1891-92. He scored some great goals at Olive Grove. He was also the first Wednesday lad to score at Hillsborough, first man to score a hat-trick. And, playing for England, he played seven times, five victories. He was the star of the finest five, which was in 1898 when England went up and beat Scotland and Scotland's fanatical followers at Hampden Park 3-1. And he scored the quickest goal in the cup final. Can't be actually guaranteed that, but certainly the Guardian and the Times have him in scoring in less than 20 seconds. And all the big games is when he performed, when Wednesday won the league in 1903. Last game, they had to beat West Brom 2-1. West Brom pressing, broke away, and Spikesley scores the goal. So that he was such a talented footballer. And actually, the one thing which was most remarkable about him, and which really does stand him out in all of English football, is he played the game by kicking the ball with the outside of his feet. And that was meant he thought you could pass the ball more quickly and much more accurately.
I think
pace-wise, there wouldn't be many players even today who could beat them for pace.
Yeah. I just think Martin's a great, maybe it exists out there already, but I haven't found it, is just the players who did it first, you know. And I always remember when I was interviewing Harry Gregg, just an absolute great of a goalkeeper.
Harry's
isn't
brilliant.
It fantastic? Wonderful man. I was lucky to see him again a couple of weeks ago. And one of the clubs he signed for, the newspaper printed a headline saying, "Congratulations, your goalkeeper is actually a sweeper," because he didn't hide under his goal, his crossbar, and he came out of his box to clear. You know, the type of goalkeeping today that we laud Manuel Neuer for, and he was doing it way back. And this is definitely that. I mean, so listen, people got to pick it up. Flying Over an Olive Grove, the remarkable story of Fred Spikesley. It's a joy to read. And as a little sidebar in that, I can't let you go without talking about this. The first ever Football League goal, because we've always thought it was somebody else, but there's a plaque today being on Tuesday in Bolton. Yes. Tell me about that.
Well, basically, me and a mate of mine, Robert Boiling, who works at the British Library, when I was doing a book before on the origins of the Football League, we were researching to find out who it was. It took us about 400 hours to find the kickoff of the Wolves Villa game in September 1888, and that confirmed that game started at 3:30, which meant what was originally thought was the earliest goal was actually 4 o'clock that day. So I had a look back, and we found out that Kenny Davenport had scored at 3:47 on that day. So myself, Gordon Taylor, and the Mayor of Bolton are unveiling the plaque in the Pikes Lane area of Bolton.
Love it.
On Tuesday, which is, you know, exceptionally good. There's a plaque actually already up at Olive Grove. It's got Spikesley's name on as well. So we're very pleased about that. One final point is we've got obviously a prize going on for a Spikesley book today. So it's, you know, at Spikesley book for people. Spikesley books, it's Waterstones, and it's on our website, spikesley.com. Mm-hmm. I know that's a plug for the book, but that's why.
No, it's good to do it, and it is out, and it's well done to you, to Clive, to Ralph and yourself, Mark.
And I finally have one small point. Obviously, today is Charlie Hurley Day at Sunderland.
Oh, yeah?
And I mean, I think that brings together, my first football book was on Charlie 8 years ago, and, you know, it was dedicated to my dad, who promised that I would mention at some point. And obviously I'm going there with my son. So I think what football is, and I think what the Spikesley book does do, is it brings together, you know, what is great about English football in a way, about going with your mates, going with your dad, going with your granddad.
Absolutely.
And going with your son, you know. And that's what we try to bring out in the book. It's a long time ago, but people who love English football definitely will love the Spikesley book,
We still build the same memories. Thank you very much. Much appreciated, Mark, and enjoy that today. Sunderland Hull today, the Charlie Hurley Day as well.